Biology and Arts here at MTS, and we're so glad to have y'all here. There's a sheet going around for your 1 hour colloquia credit, so make sure that your name gets on that sheet and that that gets left with me so that I can get that back to the registrar's office so you'll get credit for your hour today. I want to welcome you to the first Theology and Arts student event under my direction. I'm excited that you're here, and we're very excited to be introducing to you someone that most of you know very well. Dr. Matt Mathews is our current There's a seat right here. Dr. Mathews is our current exhibitor here in Founders Hall with his installation of Beauty, Whole, and Broken, and he, of course, as you know, is the professor of theology here. Today he will lead us in a conversation in which we see the intersections of his life as a theologian and his life as an artist, and I believe that we will see that they are not easily compartmentalized, nor are they separate. Growing up in central San Joaquin Valley in California, Dr. Mathews' photographs often call us towards the west, but his love for the Delta is clear in the portraits right out here in the hallway from Clarksdale, Mississippi. I hope you are inspired today and want to experience more of his work, which you can find online at mmathews, that's one T, mmathews.zenfolio, zenfolio.com. From a blog post at that site, Dr. Mathews wrote, "I do not subscribe to the artist as genius fiction, which assumes that artistic skill is an unlearned, native-born gift or burden that the artist is entitled to inflict upon the world." With that, I ask you to welcome Dr. Matt Mathews. There's one seat up here. There's a chair. There's one over there.
Come on in. Yeah,
we have some chairs on the side over here.
We'll squeeze and make room for you. So, usually when I'm in this room, I'm here to lecture. I'm not going to lecture today. We're going to have a conversation. I do have a few things I'll kind of say by way of introduction. Then I really want to open it up for a conversation together to talk about the arts generally. And for me, I don't work in all the arts. I work only in photography. Use some photographs perhaps to illustrate and have a conversation about what role the arts might play in the Christian life. We're doing a lot of thinking about that lately, and we'll have a few things to say. So I hope this is a conversation. There's a large number of us in here, which makes it a little harder to have a conversation, but let's try to do that. I don't have 5 or 4 or 6 points to make over the course of the next hour. Those of you in my next class will get that in the next 3 hours. So, we will give you a break between this and that.
Yeah, we're good.
But let me start just with a brief introductory statement. The great photographer Dorothea Lange, who photographed the Dust Bowl, and who photographed the Depression in America. You all probably know her photograph, Migrant Mother, a picture of the mother in a tent in California with her 2 children huddled against her, probably the most iconic photograph of the Dust Bowl. Dorothea Lange is famous for having said, quote, "The camera is a tool for learning how to see without the camera." And I think she gets it right, that so often photographers, like myself, become camera experts. It's as though the instrument itself becomes an object or an end in itself. But what we're really aiming for, I think, in the arts generally in photography, is that the camera is just an instrument to enable you to more faithfully live in the world, to see the world as God would have us see it and live in it. And so that really is kind of my theme. I do not offer courses in cameras. I offer courses in the spirituality of seeing. How is it that we can train ourselves to see the world more faithfully, to see it, as Calvin talks about the world, as a theater of God's glory? And in the history of Christianity and art in the West, the two have intersected in a number of different places. The first is that very often in the Western tradition, art was used to depict Christian subject matter, right? Christian scenes. So you would look at stained glass windows, perhaps, of biblical scenes. Or you would look at photographs of explicitly religious subject matter. That's kind of one strand in the Western tradition. The other strand in the Western tradition is the attempt to incorporate arts into worship. And so we have kind of this intentional efforts to integrate beautiful lyrics and beautiful music into the hymnody and the life of the church. But there's another way of thinking about the connection between theology and arts, and that's the way I kind of focus my energy. And it's on asking, how do we see the world and live into the world faithfully as an act of Christian discipleship through the arts? So my work focuses less on how do I get photographs that I can use in worship, or how do I make photographs of subject matter that's explicitly religious. You'll notice that there is nothing explicitly religious in the subject matter of this sequence of photographs. So for me, the journey into seeing is just that. It's a journey into being open and receptive, meeting the world as God would have me meet the world, coming to attend to it, to linger over the beauty that's there as an act of bearing witness to the hand of God. I'm delighted in the mystery and the wonder of the world out there as it shows forth the majesty and beauty of God. So that's my little elevator speech as to kind of why or where I make the connection as a theologian and photographer between these two forms. So let me just open it up for comments and questions. If there's an image, we have the 20 images that are up kind of strobing here. If there's one that you would like to talk about, ask questions about, we can do that. And then if we run into some dead spots, I have some things that I can read at you. But I would rather not. Yes, Shirley.
I've noticed in a lot of the things that you post on your Facebook page, you talk about, and lately anyway, you've taken some older photographs, come back, and then some additional processing while online. And I wonder, to what extent do you think that process of cropping and editing and adjusting helps you to focus on those sort of theological themes?
Yeah, that's a good question. All the way back to the beginning of photography's history, people have manipulated the image. And we often see an image on Facebook or the internet and say, oh, that was Photoshop. And often the times, it's so over the top that it kind of stretches beyond what is believable. And you say, that's so fake, it has to be Photoshopped, right? But I think a more skillful hand of editing of photographers going back all the way to the 1840s, is that many of the techniques that we do now digitally were hidden from the public because they happened in the sacred inner sanctum of the darkroom, which very few people had access to. So most of the things that we do digitally to manipulate, to crop, to adjust exposure, all of that used to be done in the darkroom chemically. Now it's just more democratic and it's come out into the open on a computer screen. But to get to your question, I think it's very important because my processing skills over the past 10 years have improved dramatically. What I can now do with an image is significantly better than it was 5, 7, 6, even 3 or 4 years ago, frankly. And I think that that's not just the acquisition of what I call, or what in the Buddhist tradition they call little knowledge, small knowledge, the knowledge of how to manipulate things in a kind of utilitarian way. It's in service of vision. A bigger way of focusing my viewers' attention on what I want my viewers to see. And the processing for me is always about removing distracting elements, in a more refined way, focusing the viewer's attention on what I think is suggestive or provocative in an image, and not trying to fake the image by oversaturating it or by modifying the content of the image. It is for me in service of a question. How can this, the way I process this image, better focus my viewer's attention on what's really mysterious or provocative or suggestive there? That's the best I can do about it. Yeah.
Along those lines, there's one image of the radioactive.
Yeah. This one.
I thought you might use that as an example. Yeah,
talk about the technical side. Yeah, okay, so this photograph is made in Prescott, Arizona. That's a little town in Bay was called that lost a team of hotshot firefighters in a forest fire a year ago. But here a year and a half ago. And there is this very interesting set of granite formations that are there. And they're gray, unlike most of the rock in the region, which is kind of red rock. And this was an old Army site, which was used for some experimental communication back in the 40s and 50s. It's since been decommissioned. And so what they did with it is they turned this place into a lake. As a recreational lake, what a wonderful place to go, peaceful and quiet. Radioactivity, let's talk about radioactivity. It is not radioactive. Granite, these particular rock formations are rich in radon. Radon gas, if you live in some parts of the country, radon gas can accumulate in your homes and basements, and it's not good for human health. And these rocks are filled with radon that is slowly emitted. It's not dangerous to human beings unless you build houses and don't have a radon removal system. But I think what Tiffany was getting at in this photograph about manipulation, this is actually two exposures. I photographed the bottom half of the scene, and then I moved the camera up and photographed the top half of the scene, and then in the software, joined them together. That way I could get a great deal of resolution in the image, and for lots of technical reasons I'll bore you with. It allows you to see far greater detail, especially in the printed version of the image. So again, is there work happening on the computer? Absolutely. Is there manipulation of the images? Absolutely. But photographs are not duplications of reality. That's one of the themes that I talk about a lot. Photographs are not merely duplications of reality, they're interpretations of reality. Where I choose to set the boundaries of the frame, how I choose to render the dark and light tones, what I choose to accentuate in the exposure, how I choose to process the image, all of that is an interpretive act. That you see that especially in black and white images where the color has been removed. It's a kind of abstraction that's focusing you on texture, line, and form, rather than trying to make you think that this is a duplication of what I saw. So again, the manipulation of the images for me is very much trying to make that in service of creating vision.
How does this image speak to you theologically?
That's a good question. How does it speak to me theologically? One of the things that when I teach photography at church sometimes, I give students the assignment of going out to do their first photograph, and I tell them, I want you to photograph whatever you experience as powerful, right? And inevitably, a few of them come back, and they have tried to photograph things which they think justify having a photography class offered in church. And so I had one woman, wonderful woman, well-intentioned, went out to Shelby Barnes, and she found a couple of fence posts that had fallen apart, had been nailed back together, and they happened to be in the shape of a cross. She photographed this thing and brought it back and said, this is my example of Christian art. And I said, trying to be diplomatic, I said, well, that's a nice first try. But I'm asking for something a little subtler than that. There's nothing religious in the subject matter here, right? I think what moves me in this photograph, and you'll see it as a theme in my art, is the power of texture, line, and curve. I think when we experience texture, line, and curve, it has a deep kind of affective resonance in us as human beings. And we sense, I have a little excerpt I can read on this, I think we sense that the world is an ordered place when we experience line and texture and curve and beauty, that the world isn't just a thrown together hodgepodge, mishmash of chance occurrences. And we have a deep kind of affective response as human beings to that sense of balance and symmetry and order and texture coming together in an image or in a scene. And I think it's there that it evokes or awakens a sense that the world is right, that this world is right the way it is made. It's not some cosmic accident. This is a right place as God intends it. And while there is suffering and pain in the world, those things are in some sense parasitic on a more basic religious truth, that this world and all of its materiality is fundamentally good. So a sense of rightness about the world, and that secondly, I think for me, awakens a sense of what I call the sense of well-being. That whoever, whatever, we're going to use theological vocabulary, the God who brings this world into being, has created a place in this world for us to flourish. We're not the center or the measure of everything, but there is still a place for us as witness bearers and observers to beauty that is hospitable to my life and to the sense that the cosmos is at some level on my side. That it's not a hostile place that's trying to snuff out my life. And I think those are both two very powerful spiritual experiences. This world is good, is as it should be, and that there's a place carved out, however small, for me to flourish and to be fully human in connection to the rest of it and to God.
But even in the midst of the destruction, the radioactivity, whatever, it's still life.
That's right. It's recognition that as much as we need to talk about the pain and suffering that necessarily attend the Christian life, those are not the first word of God. The first word of God is the goodness of creation, God's intention for the flourishing of all creatures. And I think there's an important lesson. When we start our spiritual journey in the place of pain and suffering, we're not starting it where the gospel does. The gospel starts the story in the place of creation. And pain and suffering are in some sense understood as distortions of that. And we have that basic sense that the pain and suffering isn't the norm. And I think one of the functions of art is to awaken us that kind of primordial sense that the universe is, in fact, friendly to us. And it's expressive of God's purposes and order before it becomes a place of human brokenness. Mark?
Question. When you see a scene, do you see the holy in the scene and then try to capture it in the photograph, or do you take a photograph and then see the holy in the photograph?
Yeah. If you've had me for class, you probably know that I tend to be a very linear thinker, right? 3 points, boom, 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 I emphasize logical sequence. One of the places where I get to break out of that way of being in the world is in the arts, is in photography. Because the creative process is, I think, necessarily never linear. There are no straight lines in nature, usually, right? And so, yeah, when I go out with a camera, I don't set out to impose a set of beliefs on what I see. I go out, sometimes I do, and it can be a very frustrating experience because reality is not fitting my boxes, right? Aaron Siskin, the great photographer, says, the first act that you must do is learn to relax your beliefs. Relax your beliefs. So that while you go out there with certain kind of hopes and expectations and anticipations, you're still cultivating a sensibility open to the surprise, to receptivity, to lingering in whatever gift will be given to you by God in and through this experience. Right? And then as I'm... So something will strike me in a scene, especially in this one. You can't even see the moon in this one, can you? Because that's terrible. The whole point of the shot is the moonrise. It's gone. It's this projector. These projectors don't give you the total range. Right here is supposed to be a beautiful moon. Can you see it? That was terrible. So in this scene, Martin, I photographed the Dells before, but never with a moon. And they were good photographs, but they seemed a little pedestrian. And I was there, and I was surprised as this moon came up, this beautiful moon. I'm sitting here watching this happen. I knew right away this is going to be a great photograph because it's the one piece that's been missing, right? But there's also a sense in which when you're making a photograph, when you do it a lot, it becomes habitual or second nature. I'm not thinking, you know, what's the theological meaning of the moonrise as it happens. I'm experiencing the moonrise. It's kind of like worship. When you worship, you're not engaged in kind of theological critique and assessment of what you're doing. There's a time for that, right? So it is in the art, in the making of the art, I'm kind of lost in the experience of creativity. And then often I'll get back to, I'll have a sense that I'm out there that this is going to be a really good one, that I've just made a good exposure. I can't wait to see it on the screen. But there's always an element of unpredictability, right? Did I get the mood right? Can I get the exposure right? Or how can I tweak it in the post-process? So part of it is I go out and I have to bracket busyness. I have to bracket other things in my life which are drawing my attention toward day-to-day things. And I have to go out there with a kind of receptivity and openness, relaxing my beliefs, probably defined. But also, once you're there, the creative act takes over and it becomes a kind of reciprocal interplay between the gift given and the appreciation expressed through the making of the image. And it's very much as a kind of dialectical, messy, but delightful tangle.
Is there a certain time when
the natural light is better than others? Sure. Yeah, conventional photographic wisdom says the best time to photograph is, you know, the hour after sunrise and the hour before and after sunset, right? That's when the light is softest. That's conventional wisdom. But and you know, I'm not a morning person, so when you're out in the desert in May and the sun comes up at 5:30, that means I'd have to get up at like 4 o'clock in the morning. That's not going to happen. But I usually photograph later in the evening, but I will go out most any time. While those are times when the light is most amenable to photography, there are some kinds of photography that work well in very bright light or unusual conditions. So I usually kind of, you know, take what the light gives. That's one thing you can't control in the process. Yes?
You're taking a picture.
Yeah.
See if I can ask this right. You think you've got one image,
mm-hmm.
but then when you go back later, you can find that you may have something you didn't even expect.
Yes, let me show you one in the exhibit. What has happened? I can find this guy. Yes, here. I think it'll stay there without advancing. Yeah, so down in, this is in 2013, down in Clarksdale, Mississippi at the Juke Joint Festival. And this gentleman is a maker of handmade jewelry. And I watched him for a while. And I have a post on my blog, which I'm not reading the whole thing, I'll just summarize it. Some little surprises. So I'm photographing this, you know, and immediately, like, I watch him, and there is a kind of curious irony here. Here's a man who makes handmade jewelry, but he has only one hand, right? And he has this prosthetic device on his left hand. And what I learned from a good friend of mine that was with us on this outing was that this prosthetic device is very dated. There are much better, more aesthetically pleasing artificial limbs nowadays. And so the question I had was, why doesn't he have one? Perhaps it's a financial limitation. But she said it's probably more likely the fact that these older prosthetic devices allow him far greater strength than the more aesthetically pleasing ones. They have much greater dexterity with that particular device on his prosthetic. And as somebody who works in fine metals and jewelry, it probably gives him the kind of level of dexterity that he might not otherwise have if he had a different prosthetic arm. And I talk in the blog about this photograph because what immediately struck me in response to your question was this kind of irony. And then, of course, I cut off the age of handcrafted, which is also a kind of echoing feature between the missing hand and the missing age of handcrafted, kind of a bit of visual rhyming, if you will, going on there. But what I did not see when I made the photograph, and I don't know if you can see it in the resolutions, in his natural hand, his right hand here, you may not be able to see it, he is holding a binder clip, and he's pinching the binder clip, which is in some sense kind of mimicking the pinching function of the prosthetic device. And I didn't see that when I made the photograph. And only when I got it on the computer later was it this wonderful little surprise where you have this kind of playful thing going on between even his natural hand kind of retreats into a mechanical device. He's pinching this little clip. And I went with this kind of interesting interplay. And I think photography very often works upon those little rhymes, sometimes seen, sometimes that are happenstance, sometimes that are there when it didn't make the photograph. And I talk about in the blog discussion of this photograph. Photographs are like poems, in that a poet is somebody who works and works and works to eliminate from the sentences everything that is extraneous. Photographers and poets create in the same way. We create by subtraction, by removing from the scene everything extraneous. And that's very different than many other art forms, where a painter applies paint to a canvas, or a sculptor has much greater latitude in adding things. Photographers create by subtraction. And like poems, we're trying to concentrate meaning in the fewest possible visual elements that we can, removing from the scene everything that will distract. Like poetry, we like rhyme. Here there are certain kind of visual rhyming. I talked about the missing H and the missing N, the echoing between the binder clip and the end of his prosthetic device. And then the other kind of cute irony is that while his prosthesis it is intended to mimic the color of his skin, he's actually inked up by way of tattoo his other arm, which is completely not natural looking. So it's a very interesting kind of play going on here. And the more I look at the image, we can talk about those kind of playful rhyming elements of the image, but there's also a sense in which, when I think about this image, photographers with a camera in our hand also are using a kind of prosthetic for seeing, right? That this instrument, this machine, is my way of seeing and recording in ways that my natural eye can't. So this kind of interesting identification I have with him. That just as he requires this machine to create, there's a sense in which the photographer does too. And it both limits, it also opens up creative possibilities. And for me, this kind of was one of the iconic images of the theme of broken beauty, which is one of the themes in the show, that beauty doesn't always reflect God's perfect, untouched design for things. It often does. But also, we find beauty in brokenness, beauty in the places of the tragic, the partial. And somehow, this man squeezes beauty out of whatever source of tragedy cost him his arm. And that's a deep spiritual insight, I think, for all of us. That so often we want faith and grace and the spiritual life to bypass suffering and beauty and brokenness. But in fact, in the story of the gospel story is that God's beauty and grace travel through the tragic and through the broken quite often in our lives. This is a very powerful experience to see this man making beauty out of the broken. He was just a wonderful person to watch his trade. He was kind of a little you or a people watcher. So,
Matt, would you give us your definition of beauty?
Out comes the illusion. Classically, my scholarly life has been still thinking about beauty theologically. And kind of classically, I guess I follow the tradition that says that beauty. Oops. Turn that down just a touch. Beauty is a form of proper relatedness. That when the elements of a thing can all be in a frame, but they're not beautiful unless they're brought together in a harmonious way. And in one of the books that I wrote many years ago, I give the example of a child who gets into the kitchen cabinets, pulls out the kitchen pans, and drops them from the counter, and they clang on the floor. And the parent comes in and says, "I'm so proud of my son, my daughter. Didn't you hear all those wonderful notes? Those are the same notes that Mozart hits." Right? And it's true. Many of the same notes from the pans clanging on the floor are the same notes that Mozart uses. But what's the difference? Mozart arranged them properly so that they formed kind of a fitting interconnection between the pattern and harmony and rhythm. All the pieces are there in the clanging of the pots and the pans, but it's in bringing them together in this kind of fitted, harmonious, properly related way that beauty emerges. I have a blog post also in which I talk about the difference between beauty and what's pretty. I think that's very important because so often in our culture we confuse what's beautiful with what's pretty. What's pretty is usually what pleases us on first glance, and it usually involves ornamentation, often artificial in nature, trying to embellish what is natural with what's artificial to convince ourselves that it's worth something. I think consumerism thrives on the pretty. One of the effects of experiencing pretty things instead of beautiful things is that pretty things don't change us. Beautiful things do. You can't stand before something beautiful, linger, and run your finger over the edge of beauty and not be transformed by what you just saw. I think beauty is not just about proper relatedness, but it also has a transformative effect experientially in ways that pretty does. And last, I'll just add that I think that much modern art is deeply suspicious of the language of beauty right now. That the idea is that beauty is just whatever your particular social group calls beauty, whatever's pleasing to you. I guess I'm an old Platonist. I think that beauty is actually objectively real. That beauty is, that our world is structured by God beautifully. And that beauty just isn't in the eye of the beholder. The pretty may be in the eye of the beholder, but the beautiful isn't. When we touch beauty, we're talking about the metaphysical underpinnings of creation itself, which ultimately, I think, reflect the beauty internal to God's own triune life, which is proper relatedness, perfectly expressed, I think. So that's some of my kind of thinking. I have to work on it both very well. On the back, yes, please.
When you photograph those individuals that are in these particular photographs here, mm-hmm. and in other cases as well,
yeah.
do you photograph to focus on the individuals as humanity, or do you focus upon them as the holy creations of God?
I guess I wouldn't make a distinction between those things. And I guess part of the, I say that because for me, one of the functions of the arts, it's that place where our theology gets traction experientially. And so when I look at this little boy on this bull, right, lost in absolute bliss that he is on this mechanical bull, and he is completely absorbed by it. Am I seeing a little boy having fun with a bull, or am I seeing a holy creation, image bearer of God? The answer is yes. It's not either or. Because the only way I can experience a holy created image bearer of God is in this little boy, or in this guy. For me, to try to speak abstractly, theologically, is helpful up to a point, but as an artist, as a photographer, this is the fullest expression of that theological idea, as this man is, right? It's in their particularity that you meet their humanity, but you also meet the mystery and wonder of the image bearer of God. And for me, it's inseparable from the individual human person or the individual scene that I see. Dwayne, in the back?
Sir, what drew you to Clarksdale?
It's close. well, I think two things.
It's a great history, though.
Yeah, it has a great history. There's some pragmatic things. I mean, you can do a day trip down to the Juke Drum Festival. And as Tiffany indicated when I opened, I'm from the West. I'm in California. Okay? And so my photographic sensibilities were kind of cultivated in the West Coast photographic tradition of Ansel Adams and Imogene Cunningham, these great big black and white landscapes of Yosemite that you all know from Ansel Adams. And that was